Welcome, dear viewer, to the Nicholas R. Cicada Review. As I speak, it's roughly sometime after 6 o'clock. I forget how daylight savings time works, but this is the first time I've ever done a review early in the morning. Not at night, but early in the morning. So I guess as this review goes along, I'll see the sky gradually fade in there. It's very interesting. Likewise, what we're talking about today is equally interesting. Today we're talking about a show that I think deserves a lot more recognition. Not for how good it is, but for how bizarre it is. I'm talking about Hogan's Heroes. Alright, well, of course, the other day, I was in Google, and I looked up Hogan's Heroes, and in the results, there was a result that said Hogan's Heroes Reboot, and that just got my curiosity pumping, so I clicked on it, and as it happens, there's an article about a Hogan's Heroes Reboot from September 2019. Now, that is a few months ago, you know, and I haven't heard anything about this, but then again, I don't know about any new TV shows, but, you know, there's a lot of speculation and rumors online. You know, you can find, if you're hoping for a reboot of anything, there's an article out there that'll confirm that reboot is happening, whether it's Wayne's World 3, or Rambo 6, or anything. Wallace and Gromit 6. You know, anything that you'd want, you can find an article that says it's coming out. But oh my gosh, this Hogan's Heroes reboot really scares me, because Hogan's Heroes is not a good show. I don't think a lot of classic sitcoms would be good rebooted. I mean, you know, you got, like, I Love Lucy wouldn't be good without Lucille Ball. The Honeymooners wouldn't be good without Jackie Gleason, and, you know, there are a lot of classic sitcoms that are good, like I Love Lucy or Honeymooners, and there's a lot that are bad, like Leave It to Beaver. Hogan's Heroes is one of those sitcoms that just really gets to me. So let's have an analysis of the original before we talk about the reboot and its consequences. Hogan's Heroes is a show that is really weird because there are actually very good movies about Nazis interacting with Americans. Like, for instance, there's The Great Escape with Steve McQueen. Everyone knows it. It's classic, and it's very cool because it's about Steve McQueen, and he escapes from the Nazis, which back in World War II, if you were a prisoner of war, was pretty hard to do. There's also a great movie, which is less well-known, but it's got Sylvester Stallone and Pelé, and I believe it's called Victory, and they play soccer with the Nazis, and they win, and they have to keep being prisoners of war, or actually maybe they do escape at the end, I forget, but it's very good. And it's got Pele, and he's very good at soccer. And I only know about that one because it was on a double feature disc. Got Family Dollar, which was along with Kevin Costner's American Flyer, which has even more product placement for McDonald's in it than Mac and Me, and yet no one ever talks about American Flyer, which I find kind of weird because it is a movie about biking, and you'd think that a movie about biking wouldn't want to contribute to the obesity epidemic. But what do I know? Anyway, Hogan's Heroes. It tries to be like The Great Escape every episode. And you know that the 60s are weird if you've got a show that tries to be like The Great Escape every episode. So this show is offensive because it seems to take place in an alternate history where the Holocaust didn't happen, but the Nazis were still just kind of bad guys who just kind of were anti-American or something, because the Holocaust is never mentioned. And that's what's mainly offensive here. Hogan's Heroes is somewhere between tolerably anti-Nazi to being about as neutral as Switzerland, because, my gosh, this show has so little recognition of how World War II was, actually. I mean, this show is... it's one of the most offensive shows of all time. There's a parody of it in Mad Magazine, which I hear is like one of the best parodies Mad Magazine ever did. And I haven't seen it, unfortunately, because I, you know, so much of the Mad Magazine stuff that's good from the 60s, I'll never see because the issues are so hard to come by. But, you know, I mean, hopefully they are archived, but, like, you know, they've gone bankrupt or defunct or whatever, or I don't know. They haven't been good since 1990, but they did a really good parody of Hogan's Heroes that I might never get to see. And that's sad, because I hear it was like the best, most, was just shocking parody. You know, because the fellows behind Mad Magazine are Jewish, so of course they were very upset with this offensive show that never once mentions the Holocaust. So, you know, they did what Mad Magazine does best in the 60s. Not today. Today they're garbage, but, you know. And I think Hogan's Heroes is one of those shows that's really befitting of a good parody, a good smackdown, because it's just the most... it's not funny, but you can watch an episode and you wouldn't be that offended. But Hogan's Heroes is offensive mainly for... it's not offensive for what it says. It's offensive for what it doesn't say. So we've got the main characters. The main characters are Colonel Hogan and... then you've got his four pals. They're the Hogan's Heroes. And you've got American guy. He behaves like an American at all times, just like an American from the 40s. You've got British guy. He's British, and he has a British accent, and that's his whole character. Then you've got French guy, and he's a chef, of course. All the French are chefs. You know, and his character trait is he's French. And finally, you've got black guy, and his whole character trait is... well, actually, he's treated... He's actually a pretty strong black character for the 60s, but the injustices that America did to his people are never really brought up or mentioned. And it's never mentioned that segregation inspired the Nazis, or that the Nazis used the excuse of, you know, they lynch Negroes when talking about the Jews. You know, that kind of stuff is too heavy for a sitcom. Yeah, but black guy is black, and, you know, and there's never a mention of, like, you know, the all-black units who were in the war. Or anything like... there's no Hispanic character. There's no Chinese character, which would actually fit. There's no Native American character, which is very weird, because a lot of the Native Americans were decorated heroes in World War II. And there's very little mention of anyone from the Slavic countries. So yeah, the four main characters are four Caucasians and one black guy. And then you got the Nazis, and you got two main Nazis. You got Colonel Klink, and then you got Sergeant Schultz. And Colonel Klink is played by Werner Klimper, and Sergeant Schultz is played by John Banner. And both of them are the most lazy cartoon depictions of Nazis I've ever seen. And again, I don't mind a lot of cartoon depictions of Nazis. I can tolerate, say, a cartoon of Hitler being... But much like a lot of stuff, a lot of me involving Nazis, Hitler is not in this show. He never once makes an appearance. I think maybe... I mean, he's mentioned quite a bit, but he never shows up. The only Nazis are comically inefficient. Even the Gestapo is inefficient here. They all behave like a bunch of clowns. And say what you will about the Third Reich, but it was pretty powerful. And these Nazis on Hogan's Heroes, they behave like morons 99% of the time. They make the worst possible decisions that always don't work out in their favor. And what's more, Hogan and his group are always able... I mean, they're like Steve McQueen by a million. It's the most unbelievable war story. And that I'm glad this isn't based on a true story, because it's obviously 100% fake. It's so fake because nobody could trick the Nazis this many times and get away with it. And the Nazis weren't jolly like Sergeant Schultz or stupid like Colonel Klink. They were effing evil. This show is just like is crazy. It's insane. Well, I don't know whose idea it was. I don't know. I don't know if there could be a good sitcom made in World War II. Maybe if it wasn't set in a POW camp. You know. I'm kind of surprised that the Nazis are never racist to the black guy, because I hear they were also racist to black people. Also, they never mention the unfortunate fact that millions of people died and the Nazis were killing millions. That's never brought up. There's never a mention of the Holocaust. That is insane. That, you know, because by 1960 it was out, you know, and really it's just so weird. It's such a weird artifact from the 60s, because I guess they just thought they could make a great escape every week, but they failed, because the show is junk. The Great Escape, as I've said, is a story of Steve McQueen escaping from the Nazis, and it's very good because it's about a once in a lifetime opportunity, and the will of the human spirit. It's not about Steve McQueen winning over the Nazis a million times, because you couldn't do that. It's the Third Reich. You're not going to get away with that, you know. Especially if you're a POW with no power, you're behind enemy lines. So the main character, Colonel Hogan, is just not a very he's not a good character. He's very flawed. He's incredibly horny. He can't stop talking to any woman he meets. He'll try to romance them up. So do all the other Hogan's heroes. He's a misogynist. He's a chauvinist. And mainly, he's just the most obnoxious fella. I mean, he's just annoyance beyond belief. Because we're supposed to root for him. He's the American. Except we don't. Because here's why. Because I think the show is trying to do something clever. You know, like, oh, Colonel Hogan's a colonel, and then Colonel Klink's a colonel. But Colonel Hogan is smarter, but he's the POW, so he has less power, or something like that. But it doesn't work, because Colonel Hogan is not a likable character. He's a total idiot. I mean, he's not, you know, in most, because, I mean, I guess he's not an idiot according to the writers of the show, who think he's, like, the greatest war hero that ever lived. But to the viewer, he looks like an idiot, because here's the thing. His heroes have got such an intricate setup of symbols. They've got radio contact with London. They've got tunnels all over the place that nobody ever notices. They've got thousands of escape routes to the outside world and thousands of routes of contact with the outside world, and they never try to escape. And Colonel Hogan's excuse is, oh, we can manage better here from the POW camp. Which is just the weirdest thing. Because, no, you couldn't. They would find your radio, because they can pick up radio frequencies. They would find your tunnels. Like, how inept do you have to be to have an available route for escape? And never want to, that's crazy. You never want to escape. You never long for freedom. Every morning you're marched out by the Nazis for exercise and whatnot. I mean, these guys' lives seem like a living hell. And I doubt any POW in World War II enjoyed their experience as much as these smug little bastards. Because it wasn't pleasant. It wasn't a fun time. It was complete hell. But Hogan's Heroes makes it seem like, oh, we are on the inside, so we can do all the espionage. It's like, no, you can't. No spies are that good, especially, like all Colonel Hogan has to do to get past Nazi security is just to put on a mustache or something and talk in a German accent. And he's able to pass for a Nazi, and they buy it. And that's insane. Like, Nazis can tell who's German and who's not. That's kind of their deal. They're nationalists, you know? And if you have a route of escape, you take it. You don't just pass it up because, oh, we can do it better from the inside. You can't. Now, as for the supporting cast, on the Nazi side, we've got General Burkhalter, who's big and fat. And the joke is that he's big and fat. And Colonel Klink is always saying, like, oh, he is big and fat. And then General Burkhalter will come in and he'll be like, oh, I'm sorry, sir. I didn't mean to say you were big and fat. You are lovely. You know, like, oh, haha. Colonel Klink has to be respectful to his Nazi. It's just like an old joke that gets very old very quick. And, oh, General Burkhalter has an ugly sister that he wants Klink to marry. And Klink is like, oh, no, it's an ugly woman. I don't want the ugly woman. And that gets old very, very fast. Most of the jokes on Hogan's Heroes get old very fast because it seems like the writing team had no idea what they were, I mean, it's not a funny show. It's not a funny show in any sense of the word. And then there's the other joke about how the Nazis don't like the Russians. So anytime, like, Klink or Schultz or something does something that's not right, the higher up will be like, oh, I will have you sent to the Russian front. I bet you better pack your snowshoes, buddy. You're being sent to the Russian front. Oh, look, are you there? Oh, yeah, it's time to learn Cyrillic, baby, because you're being sent to the Russian front. And it stops being funny after about the second time you hear it. It stops being funny because it's just, yeah, we get it. They don't like the Russians. So, Germans don't like the Russians. That's all there is to it. It's not funny. It's never really was funny. It's just, oh, that's the only threat we've got that's humorous. Because I guess most forms of Nazi torture aren't very funny. But aside from that, the show seems very smug in these weird observations that it thinks it makes about the time. It thinks it makes all these, the Nazis weren't that bad. They were pretty inefficient. They were pretty, bad at managing their prison camps, the French fella wasn't that angry that the Nazis had, invaded his country and were stealing all the art and destroying it. He was just like, oh, Cornell Hoagie, let me cook you up a salad. Ha ha, yeah. Or, oh, the, it's just a very gross show. Because it's so bad, in that you really can't make a sitcom about the Third Reich, because it wasn't a jolly time for anyone, actually. So, maybe not the best sitcom material, my guy. I left out two characters. There is Russian Lady, who shows up every now and again. Her gimmick is she's Russian and has a Russian accent. Also, there's Colonel Crittenden, and he's British, and he talks like Elmer Fudd. And the joke is, he talks like Elmer Fudd. There's a lot of allusions to Looney Tunes in Hogan's Heroes, which is weird, because it's not funny like Looney Tunes. I think there's a Nazi themed Looney Tunes that's funnier than Hogan's Heroes, and that's kind of sad because Hogan's Heroes thinks it's so funny, and Hogan's Heroes are the tricksters, and they're playing wacky pranks on the Nazis. It's really just very insane. I don't know why anyone would make a sitcom like that. I don't know what they were thinking, what got into their heads. It's not a funny sitcom, but there are some moments in it when it'll try to be serious for just a moment, and it'll have a nice serious moment where, say, Colonel Hogan is leaning up to the camera, and he's like, he's got some lady with him, and the lady will be like, "Please, Colonel Hogan, they're holding my father hostage, and they're going to kill him unless you save him somehow. They're going to kill my father." And then Colonel Hogan, being the big horny American that he is, will be like, "Gimme another smooch dumpling." Ah, laugh track. Oh, wow. And that's the point at which I just give up, because this show has nothing. It has nothing. It's like a blank, clean slate. It's like a... I don't know why I said that. It's like a pool of vomit that just drips down. It just drips down. It's the least effect... It's the least... You can't root for the heroes, because none of them are interesting or well written, and the Nazis aren't that evil, which is insane, because of course they were, And the Holocaust is never mentioned, and there's one minority in the whole thing. And it's very weird. So, what can you do? Well, there are quite a few sitcoms that should be rebooted. Say there's Fresh Prince of Bel-Air with Will Smith. Will Smith is still alive. If there was a reboot of Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, it would be fine. Say there's a reboot of Seinfeld. Say there's a reboot of Friends. I don't like Friends. I don't get the buzz around it. But yeah, you know, at least the people in it are still alive and could do a reboot. You know, there could be a reboot of a lot of sitcoms. Seinfeld, Bel-Air. There could be a reboot of Herman's Head. But, you know, just don't make a reboot of a show that nobody cares about, that very few people remember, that isn't good, that's highly offensive, and that all the people in are dead. That's a very strange choice, because I don't know who wants a show made. I don't know what kind of what you know whose popular opinion is this? Nobody cares about this stupid show, 'cause it's done. It's done. And you know, I you know, just be sure to insist that whichever network has this travesty running on it, this stupid reboot, to go shove it and just, you know, out of all the things that you can cancel in this day and age, since cancel culture is a thing, cancel this awful reboot of this awful show that's no good. Thanks for watching. Yeah. I'll end saying this, that one of the least funny movies of all time, The Pest, has one scene where John Leguizamo is watching Hogan's Heroes. So at the very least, I guess unfunny people share a common enjoyment of humor or something. I don't know. And with that, I'll leave you. And the fact that it's dawn out, the street lights have turned off and the house lights remain on, and I stand here in my lonely vigil against abhorrent media. The sun will be out soon, sparkling on this mid-January day, and good heavens. Hope that's about it. It's been a fine review. Just figured this thought was nagging at me. The thought that I needed to make a review of Hogan's Heroes and share it with you people for the love of God, because Hogan's Heroes is the worst show. Or, not the worst show, but one of the worst shows I've ever seen. You know what's jolly? And the World War II? Yeah, that's the best sitcom ever. Man, oh wow. So yeah, that's it. Yeah.